in the University of Pennsylvania, supervised by Jose Maria Diego, Gary Bernstein, and also Mariangela Bernardi. And there he studied different aspects of gravitational lensing within galaxy clusters, self-interacting dark matter, also the Hubble frontier fields, the supernova Resval, and the deep learning morphological catalog that he is going to present today. Since 2020, he is working at IFCA, but also with a double affiliation in the IIIA Institute, the Institute of Inteligencia Artificial, no? And he's working with the Athena mission to identify pulses using machine learning techniques. So Jesus, you have the word whenever you want.
Hi everyone. Can you see my screen now? Okay, I guess.
Yes.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to present this work here. So I want to thank the Institute and the PISA seminar organizer for giving me this opportunity. Today I'm going to present our latest publication with the largest galaxy morphological catalog up to date. We push the limits to the automatic morphological classification of galaxies using the Dark Energy Survey. And this is a work done in collaboration with Elena Dominguez Sanchez, Mariangela Bernardi, and Mark Huerta's company, mainly, but also the DS is within the DS collaboration. No. So this is the summary of my talk today. I will start by introducing a little bit why galaxy morphologies are important for galaxy evolution and formation studies. I also describe how to classify I will also explain how to classify large samples of galaxies using automated algorithms, and in particular I will describe how deep learning can be used for galaxy classification. In the second part of my talk, I will jump into the description of the deep learning algorithms that we are going to use to classify DS galaxies, explaining the training and test datasets and the two classification schemes that we perform over the DS galaxies. And in the third part of my talk, I will present the morphological catalog, which is the largest one up to date. And I will also present some slides on validation, on the validation on real DS galaxies, and I will end up with the conclusion. So for the introduction, as you may already know, galaxies exhibit a wide variety of shapes, and I would say that as humans, there are no two identical galaxies in the universe, but we tend to group them into this Hubble de Bacculer's diagram, in different groups, and in particular, there is the T-type classification that tries to split the whole variety of galaxies that we observe in the universe in 14 types, and this is called the T-type classification. So if we start from the left part of the panel, we have the elliptical galaxies that in the most extreme part, so the T-type of the -3 or -2, these are rounded galaxies and they become more elliptical. There is a transition between this part of the diagram and the fork part of the diagram, which are called the lenticular galaxies. And when you move towards the right part of the panel, the spiral galaxies start to appear. So mainly we usually divided in astronomy the galaxies in two main groups, the early type galaxies, which are the elliptical plus the lenticulars that are included in this group with T-types that are very close to zero. And we have also the late type galaxies or spiral galaxies. The spiral galaxies exhibit also a wide variety of morphologies. So in the top arm of this diagram, you have the spirals that become the spiral arms become more evident as you move towards the right and more separate. And also the hydrogen star formation regions are more important. It is also important to highlight that in the spirals, also in the lenticulars, there is a two components. So there is a bulge plus a disk. And in the spirals, the disk is very evident. We have also a second group of spirals that are called the barred spirals, because you can see the presence of a bar in the middle, in the center of the galaxy. And there is a transition between this spiral, intermediate spiral, and the barred spirals. So the main difference between the two types, the late type galaxies and the early type galaxies, is that the late type, the spiral galaxies, are low mass galaxies when compared to the massive early type ellipticals. They have young stellar population and they still form new stars, mainly in the spiral arms. Support most of the star formation in spiral galaxies, and they are rotationally support and because of the conservation of the momentum, the energy momentum, they form disk. This is a phase on galaxy, but if we could observe the same galaxy in a edge on, we will see a very prominent disk. On the other hand, the early type galaxies, also called ellipticals, are massive galaxies. They tend to be redder than the spirals, and this is not only because they stop forming galaxies, so they are populated with all stars, but also because there could be some extinction. And these are velocity dispersion dominated, so there are random motions these are dominated by random motion of stars. And for example, why these galaxy morphologies are important and how they relate to other important parameters, for example, the stellar population or the mass accretion history of the galaxies. This is a very nice plot from Weitz 2011, in which you have the logarithmic of stellar formation rate, so the amount of stars per year that the galaxy formed, versus the logarithmic of the mass of the galaxy. And in color, you have here this what is called the Cercic index that can be a very good proxy of the morphology of the galaxies. So for instance, Cercic index below 2 or 3, so below, let's say in the middle of this color bar, below 2.5, tend to be a spiral. And on the other hand, higher values of the Cercic index usually correspond to early type galaxies or ellipticals. And for example, these three panels shows the star formation versus the mass for three recipe bins. So this is local, intermediate, and high recipe. And you can see how the color coding separates the group of early type galaxies of elliptical that tend to be more massive, as I just mentioned, and also with lower star formation rate than the spirals that are colored in this green blue colors. And for example, as you move to the higher redshift, you can separate the two classes, but there is a transition between spirals that become elliptical as we move to lower redshift. Another important work done by Mark Huerta's company separate between these spheroidal galaxies, disky galaxies, the two components, disk plus spheroidals, and the irregular galaxies. And in this plot, in these panels, you can see the stellar mass density, the logarithmic of the stellar mass density versus the age of the universe or of the redshift here. And this panel corresponds to all the galaxies in the sample. This panel shows only the star-forming galaxies, and this panel shows the passive galaxies, or also denoted as elliptical galaxies. And it is important to relate how these properties, the stellar mass density and the cosmic time, evolve for the different species, for the different types of galaxies. For example, at redshift about 2, 80% of the galaxies are dominated by irregulars. And you can see there is a transition from irregulars to disky galaxies as around redshift of 1. For example, for passive galaxies, most of the galaxies at redshift about 0.2 are dominated by spheroidal galaxies. But when you move to lower resid between 2 and 1, you can see that the bulge, this branch here, also not dominates, but also takes more importance in the proportion of the different types of galaxies. So what I want to illustrate with these last two slides is that understanding how morphology relates to galaxy properties and in which way they affect galaxy assembly and evolution is one of the major challenges of present-day astronomy. And therefore, it is crucial to have accurate morphological galaxies, not only for last sample of galaxies, but also for galaxies across cosmic time. So we can study not only how the galaxy forms, but also how they evolve with cosmic time. So since it is important to classify and to have good statistics of morphologies, of galaxy morphologies, there are different ways to do that. And the classical of the most traditional way is by visual inspection, but this is extremely time consuming. And for example, this will take for around 100 years to classify by the Euclid dataset when launched. Another way to do that is to rely on the opinion of the classification done by amateur astronomers. And this effort was mainly done by the Galaxy Zoo collaboration, in which, as I say, amateur astronomers classify thousands of galaxies. But this classification has some caveats, because even for astronomers, will be difficult to agree in some classification for some galaxies, and that will be even more difficult if we go to higher resid of to fainter magnitudes. So it is difficult to rely on these classifications. And this is why automated algorithms came to the rescue. And at the beginning of this century, there were different studies like Abraham, Conselice, or Lotz in 2008. For example, Lotz in 2008 used some parameters like stellar formation, asymmetries, or the Gini coefficient that are related to the morphology to study morphology using artificial intelligence or machine learning, like the support vector machine or the Bayesian automatic classification performed by Marwertar company over the Candles survey or the Sloan Digital Sky survey. In the last, let's say, 5 years or so, also supervised deep learning algorithms have been demonstrated as a unique tool for morphological classification of large samples of galaxies. And there are very good examples like Dillmann 2015, Marwertar's company 2015, and also Elena Dominguez in 2018, where there was the largest catalog before we published this work. And Elena classified more than 600,000 galaxies from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, providing the astronomical community with T types for more than 500,000 galaxies. So what is deep learning and how can we use it for galaxy classification? So in this slide, I make a composition on what is artificial intelligent machine learning and deep learning. And I like this figure here because it describes very concisely what is its class. For example, artificial intelligence can be defined as a technique which enables machine learning to mimic human behavior. By mimic human behavior, we refer to how the human brain learns by showing the brain with several examples. Machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence techniques which uses this statistical methods to enable machines to improve with experience. So it's like the human brain. And deep learning is again a subset of machine learning which make the computation of multi-layer neural network feasible. So in deep learning, we use neural networks that are connected as the neurons in our brain to classify data sets of objects. It could be galaxies, or it could be cats and dogs, or cars and trucks, or whatever. Artificial intelligence started to take some importance in science at the beginning of the 50s in the previous century, but it was around the 80s when machine learning pushed the artificial intelligence, and many people started using it, and many publications arise from this year. There were also in this period what is called the AI winters, where the computational resources were not sufficient to compute or to take to produce any satisfactory results using machine learning. But in the last decade or so, deep learning has catapulted the use of machine learning and artificial intelligence in the science field. And you can see in this histogram here the number of publications in deep learning, not only astronomy or astrophysics, so in all the brains from biology to branches, sorry, from biology to medical sciences, taken from 2006 to the mid to June 2017. And you can see the exponential growth of the number of publications the last 15 years. The main difference that I want to highlight in these two figures here is that machine learning needs kind of a pre-processing step before the classification is done by the neural network. So the human has to extract the features from images, for example, and then plug it into the neural network to classify if, for example, the input image is a car or if it's not a car. Deep learning, on the other hand, does by itself the feature extraction. So there is one part of the neural network that perform the feature extraction and another part of the neural network that classify according to these feature maps that were extracted in the first stage. When we are talking about deep learning, the input can be, there are two types of deep learning, the unsupervised deep learning that consists of finding patterns in the images, or the supervised deep learning. So the input data has to be labeled. For example, in our case, we are going to feed the neural network with the early type, with the two types of galaxies that I presented in the first slide, the early type galaxies and the late type galaxies. And we will train the neural network to distinguish between the two types to have an output of which type belongs to a galaxy image that has never passed through the neural network. This is a typical CNN architecture to classify galaxies that has been used. It's not exactly the same as in Dillman, Mar Huerta's company of Dominguez Sanchez, but it's pretty similar to the CNN's use in this previous work. And as I mentioned before, the CNN is split in two. So you have the convolutional blocks. You have 1, 2, 3, and 4 convolutional blocks that extract features in different scales. I will explain in more detail what these red squares mean. And then you have a fully connected layer that will be like a pure neural network. These fully connected layers are composed by neurons, and all of the neurons are connected to the neurons in the next fully connected layer. Here is a little bit of detail how the convolutional blocks works. So for example, in a convolutional layer, if your input image is, if the input image is an 8, you have the value in each pixel. Sorry, the video, okay. You have the value in each pixel. Imagine that your image can be translated to this green array here. And this is the convolutional filter. So this is the red square here. 6 times 6 is the size of the pixel. This filter will be a 3 times 3. It's just an example to illustrate what is happening in these convolutional blocks. And this is the result of convolving the filter with the image. So you move the filter across your image and you convolve it by multiplying that, by doing convolution, linear combination of the values of the image and the weights of the image. Depending on the shape of your filter, the weights on your filter, here the weights are 0 and 1, depending on how your filter is designed, you can extract, for example, the filter is more robust on detecting edges or sharpen the edges or blurring the image. So when we initialize the neural network, these weights in the filters in the different convolutional blocks are randomly assigned. And then during the training phase, these weights adapt to extract the features that are important for classifying the images according to whatever criteria we impose. In each convolutional block, there is also a ReLU activation function that introduces some nonlinearity. For example, a basic example of what the ReLU does is converting all the negative is doing zero all the negative values in the feature map extracted from the convolutional block. And this is an example of on a real image of buildings and how the filter moves across the image and how the feature map is produced. And you can see how the borders, the edges of the buildings in the image are highlighted with respect to the original image. And there is also the pooling layer, use the dimension before connecting with the subsequent convolutional or fully connected layer. Then in the final step, when you arrive to the fully connected layer, these feature maps enters here. Usually there is a flatten that converts your array, your feature map array into a vector. And each point of this vector is connected to a neuron. For example, here we have 64 neurons that then are connected to the output neuron. So when your input is a galaxy, at the end you will have a value, only one value that tells you if this galaxy corresponds to one class or to another class. This is a very simple case because we are in a binary classifier, so we wanted just the CNN to tell us this is a early type galaxy or this is a late type galaxy. Okay, so we jump to the second part of the talk where I will describe how we define the training and test data sets. And this is probably one of the most important part of the work because since we are using supervised deep learning, we need a prior labeling. So we need the galaxies to have some labels if they are early type or late types. And this is considered as our ground truth. So for doing that, since we didn't want to spend years classifying by eye the galaxies within the dark energy survey, we used Dominguez Sanchez et al. Catalog with a T-type classification that provide us with a T-type classification for 600,000 Sloan galaxies that was trained on a visual dataset performed by Naira Abraham in 2010. The visual classification is composed of 14,000 galaxies, more or less. So in Dominguez Sanchez et al., they trained a convolutional neural network similar to the one that I am using in this work to provide with a T-type classification. And they obtain a very good accuracy of 97%. So we can trust the labels that this catalog contains. And this is a plot with the T-time derived by the CNN in Dominguez Sanchez, and this is the true T-type. And as you can see in this panel, the scatter versus the T-type is larger at the intermediate types. So when we were looking at the Hubble-Debakulers diagram, I mentioned that we tend to group galaxies into these 14 categories, but the transition between one category and the other is smooth. So there is no a jump in between categories. And and the transition close to the lenticular, so close to a T-type around zero, has larger scatter because it's very difficult even for expert astronomers to agree, for example, in what class, to what class a lenticular galaxy belongs. So for this reason, then we have this catalog with more than 500,000 galaxies. We cross match the catalog, the T-type catalog with the DES footprint, the GR3 gold catalog. It is important to highlight that the the Sloan Digital Sky Survey is magnitude limited, so it goes up to roughly 18 magnitudes. And there is a cross match of around 20,000 galaxies between the Sloan and the DS survey. So for that subset of galaxies, we produce cutouts using the G, R, and Y bands in the DS survey with a cutout size of 11 times the half-life radius. So for example, to produce the cutouts here, this is a local galaxy, the original image, which correspond to 11 times the half-life radius here, is a galaxy image of roughly 500 pixels. And this image here, the right-hand panel, correspond to a very faint and far away galaxy. So for the same size, 11 times the half-life radius, this cutout correspond to a 32 times 32 pixels. So what I want to highlight here is that we didn't fix cutout size for all the galaxies, but we adjust the cutout to have the galaxy centered in the cutout with some background around it. And so we didn't want to miss any spiral arm feature by doing the cutouts very small. As I mentioned, since the scatter is very high in theta is close to zero, we also excluded the lenticular galaxies or S0 with theta is between -0.5 and 0.5. We want the CNN to be trained with very clear examples of the two families of early types and late type galaxies. At the end, we have a primary sample after cleaning, for example, for spectroscopy recessive or missing spectra in some galaxies. Instead of 20,000, we end up with 17,000 galaxies. But they are limited to 17.7 magnitude. Since we want to go to finer objects and we want to be able to classify more a huge number of galaxies, and since there are more fainter galaxies than brighter galaxies in the universe, we wanted to expand the limits in magnitude. And this is why we simulate the 70,000 galaxies that we have in our primary sample. We simulate them as they look as they were at a higher redshift. And we impose some limits in magnitude to 22.5, redshift limit of 1, and also we exclude galaxies with very small radius, because for example, for the most extreme cases like this one, almost all the information of the galaxy is concentrated in a few pixels in the center of the image. We simulate the cosmological dimming, both in the flash and the size of the image, and we include some K correction and evolution for the two types of galaxies that we have. We also deconvolve and convolve by the PSF, and we added noise to the images. And here in this panel, we have an example of the same galaxy. This is the original galaxy in the primary sample, a redshift 0.03. And this same galaxy is simulated up to redshift 0.4 by keeping the original label. So this is a LTG, a late-type galaxy or a spiral galaxy. So we keep the label and we train our CNN with the same label, but with these simulated images. Two examples on how we use Galsim to simulate the galaxies at fainter magnitudes or larger redshift. This is a spiral and this is an elliptical. And if you move towards the right, you can see that the same galaxy becomes to be more noisy and the spiral arms are difficult to detect. And what I want you to focus in is in the last beam, for example. If I don't tell you anything, or at least in my opinion, I won't be able to distinguish between these two, apart that these are mixed. This is the LTG is here and the ETG is in the bottom, sorry. So it is very difficult by the human eye to distinguish between these two types when we go to the limit of magnitude, 21.5. This is a description of the training and the test sample. So we have the primary sample. We reserve 1,000 galaxies for testing. And then we simulate two counterparts of the same galaxy. So these 16K galaxies, we perform a random sampling, is this distribution here. We wanted to populate intermediate magnitudes. You see that the primary sample, the blue histogram, ends in 18 magnitudes. So by simulating those galaxies, we want to extend our magnitude limit. And we also performed, we also reshifted the galaxy, each galaxy, to the maximum redshift or magnitude within the limits that we impose here. So 22.5 or redshift 1, or the size of the image. Because when you move the galaxy towards a higher redshift, not only the flash, but also the size is smaller. But what I want you to keep in mind is that we kept the original labels for the training. This is the convolutional neural network trained in a binary mode. So we have ATG versus LTG. The input galaxies are RGB images with the G, R, and Y bands in 64 by 64 pixels. So galaxies with a larger size of the cutouts are degraded to 64 by 64, and galaxies with smaller cutout sizes are interpolated to this 64 by 64, which is the input of our CNN. And we use the what is called the K-fold so split our training sample in this way, so we can provide with 5 different models for each galaxy. Okay, so for the ATG versus LTG classification scheme, this is a little bit of basics of deep learning. So for testing our results, we compare the confusion matrix, the Rho curves, and also we compute precision, recall, and accuracy. So for example, this is the true label. This will be LTG's ATG. So if the model is correct and classifying a spiral galaxy, that will be a true positive. If it's correct classifying a elliptical galaxies, these are called the true negative. And we have also the false positives and the false negative. For example, for the result for the test sample are highlighted in these plots here. So as I just mentioned, for each galaxy, we have 5 different probabilities, and we can compute a median probability that usually is a best estimate of the morphology than the individual models. And for example, you can define a probability threshold which minimizes the false positive rate and maximizes the true positive rate in the Rho curve. And this is the probability threshold for 0.4 that better splits your sample and has a higher accuracy. For example, this will be a threshold here. So all galaxies with a probability below that threshold will be ellipticals, and all galaxies above that threshold will be spirals. So we obtain a secure classification for 92% of our dataset. So by secure classes, we impose this condition here so that the difference between the maximum and the minimum probability of the 5 different models is below 0.3. That will be secure classification. The insecure classes are only 8% of the sample, but still, if you keep the median probability of the 5 models, 80% of the unsecure classes are still correctly classified. And this is a confusion matrix for the ATG versus LTG classification, where you can see how the accuracy is around 97% for if you combine both the ATG and the LTG. So we reach a very high accuracy for our test sample. And in this plot, we wanted to see if there is some dependence with the galaxy brightness, with the apparent magnitude. So in this panel, we have the apparent magnitude versus the precision, recall, and the accuracy. So this is the area under the Rho curve, the precision, the recall, and the accuracy. And I just wanted to show that this axis goes down to 90%. So even if there is some scatter and for some magnitude bins, the classification is slightly worse, we are always in the whole magnitude range above 92% accuracy or precision, okay? The precision can be interpreted as a purity of the sample, and the recall, on the other hand, can be interpreted as the completeness of your classification. And for example, So this panel here for the faintest galaxies having an accuracy of the order of 98%, even for the fainter galaxies, what highlights is that the CNNs can detect features that are hidden to the human eye, or at least to my human eye, because I won't be able, if nobody tells me, the difference between these four galaxies here, or the top panels and the bottom panel. Then we also perform edge-on versus face-on classification. So the CNN is the same, but instead of labeling the galaxies in early types or late types, we label the input galaxies according to the probability of being edge-on or face-on in the Dominguez Sanchez et al. Catalog. We perform the same simulation, so each galaxy in the primary sample is simulated randomly and to the maximum residue of magnitude. So for each primary galaxy, we have two counterparts, two simulated counterparts. I'm running out of time, but we have very good results also for this classification. So we have accuracies for the test sample of the order of the 98%, and 93% of the sample has secure classification. Second classification scheme, the edge-on versus face-on. So you can see the accuracy is between 99 and 98%. And the same with the magnitude. So we don't see any trend with magnitude. So we are very confident that our classification are reliable for the whole magnitude beam up to 21.5, which is three times or 1,000 times in flux deep than the previous catalog done by Dominguez Sanchez with over the Sloan Digital Sky Surveys galaxies. Okay, and I'm jumping now to the last part of my talk where I present the morphological catalog and I validate our results on real DS galaxies. So the morphological catalog, the final morphological catalog, contains roughly 27 million galaxies. The magnitude limit is 21.5 in the airband. The galaxy size, so we only classify galaxies about 2.8 pixels, which corresponds roughly to less than 0.7 arcseconds, 0.8 arcseconds, because the pixel size of the DCAM is 0.26 arcseconds per pixel. The 98% of the galaxies in the catalog are between redshift 0 and 1, but we cover the full redshift range with good statistics, and just 2% of the galaxies are about the redshift 1. And these are more or less repeating the same. 87% of the ATG versus LTG classification are secure. And we have 10% robust ATGs. By robust ATGs, what we highlight here is that the maximum of the five probabilities that we present in this catalog is below 0.3. So we can be very, this classification for 10% of the elliptical galaxies are very reliable. And 80% for the spirals are also reliable. So the five models agree that the probabilities are above 0.7 for the five models. And when combining, I want to highlight here the last point here, when combining the first classification scheme with the second classification scheme, the second classification scheme can be used to detect misclassification or elliptical galaxies or H-on lenticulars, because it is not possible that an elliptical galaxy, since it's more spherical, is seen edge-on. So when the combination of the two classifications gives you that you have an elliptical and edge-on, we recommend the user to look in detail to those classes, because that could be a misclassification or a lenticular, edge-on lenticular.
So 3 minutes remaining, okay?
Okay. So... this is the magnitude distribution. The blue histogram here is the magnitude distribution of the whole morphological catalog containing the 27 million galaxies. And you can see here, in this hexagon diagram, the apparent magnitude versus the photo redshift. You can see that most of the galaxies are faint galaxies with magnitudes of 21 or above. You can see how the secure fraction of the classification varies in this two-dimensional plot. So spirals, and I'm sorry, and you hear, you have here in the last panel, the fraction of LTGs. So blue are spirals, blue are 100% of the galaxies are spirals. Zero means that all the galaxies in the hexagon bin are ellipticals, and white points is a combination of both. So you can see how the spirals populate, the spirals are more secure classification. And when there is a combination of two, the secure fraction is drops to 0.5. So 50% of the galaxies are secure in this bin, but it's only a small fraction in this part here. And these are some examples of elliptical galaxies in the top row, intermediate galaxies, so galaxies with intermediate probabilities, and spiral galaxies. And from left to right, we're going to bright or close towards fainter or far away galaxies. And again, I want to highlight that in the last two bins in magnitude, for example, around 20 or 21 in magnitude, it is already very difficult for me to distinguish between this one here and this one here. But the CNN is able to detect the features important to classify these galaxies into types. These are five examples of edge-on galaxies and also five examples of edge-on elliptical galaxies. So this looks like elliptical galaxies, elongated. No features, no spiral arms, almost no bulge, but they look more like lenticular galaxies. We validate our catalog on real DS galaxies by comparing with three different catalogs. One is the stellar mass catalog. I'm going to skip this part because I'm running out of time. So I think it's more important, for example, if we go to the comparison with the DSGR1 structural parameters catalog published by Tarsitano in 2018. In this catalog, we have 5 million galaxies with Cercic indices and ellipticities measured using ALFID. And we cross-match the Tarsitano catalog and our catalog, and we found 6 million galaxies with accurate photoseas and Cercic indices and ellipticities. And we also measured that almost 90% of these 6 million galaxies are secure classification according to our catalog. And this is a plot with the Cercic index in the vertical axis and the ellipticity as derived by Tarsitano. And the color coding in this panel here is the number of galaxies. So most of the galaxies have Cercic indices below 2. This correspond to spiral galaxies roughly. So the transition between spirals and ellipticals is between 2 and 4. And that is highlighted in this panel where in color, we have the predicted fraction. So red is elliptical. Most of the galaxies in the bin are ellipticals, and blue spirals. So you can see how the transition between spirals and ellipticals start at around 2, and half of the galaxies are spiral and half of the galaxies are elliptical at around a Cercic index of 4. Also, when we compare the radius of the galaxy in R-second, which is the vertical axis here, versus the ellipticity, and we compare the ellipticity measured by Tarsitano with our classificator, with our classifier, we can see that almost all the galaxies with an ellipticity about 0.5 are classified as edge-on galaxies, which is a very good result. And if we project these panels into a one-dimensional histogram, we have here the cumulative distribution function versus the Cercic index. And these are our classification, robust ellipticals and robust spirals. 97% of the ellipticals has Cercic index, above 2. So this is a very good result. And 86% of the spirals, this point here, show Cercic indices below 2. So this was a very, very satisfactory test or sanitary check for us. I already talked a little bit about the ellipticity. So I'm going to jump into the last comparison that we attempt with the Viper spectral classification published by Shudek et al. In 2018. In this catalog, they have almost 90,000 galaxies with spectral classes by using an unsupervised algorithm with 12 res frame image and spectroscopy residue. They classify the galaxies in 12 spectral classes that can be divided into four types: passive, intermediate, star-forming galaxies, and active galactic nuclei. When we cross-match this 90,000 catalog with our 27 million catalog, we obtain almost 8,000 galaxies to compare with very good spectroscopy receive. For this catalog, our classification are secure for more than 80% of the sample. And I want you to focus in this histogram here, which is the cross-match between the Vipers and the Dies. And this is the fainter galaxy sample here. So we are comparing here the results for very faint galaxies, but with very robust spectral classes. And this is the final plot of my talk today. So in color, in red, we color the elliptical galaxies. So the red histogram corresponds to our classification of elliptical, and the blue histogram corresponds to our classification of spirals. And classes, spectral classes below four are considered passive. Intermediate in the spectral classification are those with classes between four and six, and star-forming galaxies are those with classes above six. And the important result, and we were very, very happy and very shocked when we saw this plot, because these are very faint galaxies, as I just mentioned, is that of our ellipticals has a class, spectral class below four, and just these few galaxies here are considered probably as misclassification. And also, more importantly, 97% of the galaxies that we classify as spirals has classes above six. So this was a very, very satisfactory sanity check for our catalog on real DS galaxies. I leave you with the conclusions. So everything that is highlighted here, I already mentioned. I just wanted to point you to the publication of our paper that was published 3 months ago in MNRS. And the public catalog probably is not yet accessible because people in the DS collaboration have the collaboration meeting this week, but people in DS are working to upload the catalog to this link here. And I wanted to thank the people from the communication group at the ICE, in particular to Alba Calejero and Paula Talero for the dissemination and the outreach and the press release that they announced a few weeks ago. And yeah, that was my last slide. Sorry, I was 2-3 minutes above the time.
Thank you, Jesus. Are there any questions? Please speak up, raise your hand, or write in the chat. Don't be shy, I cannot ask a question because I know all the content of the paper, so please. Okay, so if there are no questions, we will thank Jesus again. And thanks for attending the pizza seminar. See you next week.
Thank you everybody for attending. I hope you enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.